Let's continue our journey with Magit and let's repeat the flow we did in the previous episode, but with some twists and additional adjustments so that you can see what can be done with Magit, and maybe this will help you to integrate that into your own workflow. As always, we start from the status page. So I'm pressing space GG to open that page, to open that buffer. And as you can see, in the meantime, I made some dummy empty commits. But I realized I would like to mark one of those commits with a tag. So in a traditional command line workflow, you would have to first find the hash of a particular commit and then use the tagging. Here in this buffer, almost everything is actionable. I'm interested in this particular commit here. I'm moving my cursor to that line, and now I can just press T as I did before, and T again to create a tag, let's say 2. And now the first place, the default place, is the commit I'm currently selecting. So I can just press enter without doing anything more. And as you can see, I marked one of the past commits in a very convenient way with a T command. Now I can move through those commits and I can just press enter to review them. So for example, this is the initial commit and I see the author, the files that have been changed and the changes as well. So usually this buffer is displayed on the right side, but because I'm using a bigger font for the screencast, it's at the bottom. I can quickly close that with Q. Let's now continue with our changes. So I did some additional improvements, so to speak, to the mixture of those two poems, one by Edgar Allan Poe and the other one by Lord Byron. I did those changes and now I would like to commit them. I realized that's not exactly what I wanted. I don't want to make all those changes. I would like to just make a part of that. So with Magit, it's pretty easy. I can just select a particular change. Let's imagine that I would like to just remove the first line and the last line from this whole section. So in that case, all the lines in between, I want to disregard them. So I don't want to remove them. So I'm selecting it with Shift V in my case, and I'm just pressing X to discard them. So I'm just discarding a subsection of a chunk in Git, which is not possible to my knowledge using the Git command line. And I press yes. So now as you can see, only those two parts will be removed. So now I can just select it or just select the whole and use S to stage them. So if we go to the stage changes, as you can see, only those two external outside lines are removed. So let's repeat that. In this case, I was adding a whole section, a whole verse from Lord Byron. After doing that, I decided that it's not what I wanted, and I'm only interested in a part of that. So I'm only interested in the first half, let's say. So I'm selecting it again with Shift V, the part I want from a chunk, and I'm pressing S to stage that. I'm not interested in the other chunk, so I'm selecting that part and I'm pressing X, discard this. And those three lines, I don't want to commit them. I just want one, so I'm discarding those two with X and this one with S. So now if I go to the stage changes, as you can see, I only have those two external lines for the first adjustment and only half included in those stage changes. So now what is left to do is to press C to commit and again C to confirm. We will review possible options later in later episodes. And in the previous episode, we just quickly glanced over this screen over here. But before you make your commit, you can review those changes. So you can switch to this lower buffer in this case, and you can see which files you are changing and what changes there are actually. And if you are happy with that, you can just write your commit. And if not, you can just quit. Let's do that. And you are back to the status page with the changes still in the staged section. But we want to commit those. So let's do CC. And let's save. So I'm still working on the profanity branch. And now would be a good moment to push those changes to a remote repository. I can now press uppercase M to see my remote URL. So in this case, I already created a repository on GitHub, which is called the Raven by Paul. If I use the push command, I will be pushing to that remote repository. So let's do that. So before, let's press the question mark to review the commands. Push command is the uppercase P. So let's push that. We are not interested in arguments at this point. So let's just take a look at the second section, which is push profanity 2. And you have three options here. The first one is push remote, and this is what we will be using here. The second one is upstream. We will dive into that in the future episodes in more detail. But for now, I would like you to remember that push remote is your remote, and upstream is usually somebody else's remote. And if you are working on your own repository, the push remote and upstream will be the same. If you are working with a team on a repository where you are pushing your topic branches directly to that repository, in that case, those two will be also the same, but this is not probably not a proper way of doing that. Those two will be different if you are forking somebody else's repository, and then you will be pushing first to your own fork with P, and then comparing your changes as you go using U with the original repository, the one from which you forked. So in our case, we will be using P, and it provides me with the origin, my own repository. So I can just push to that. So let's take a look at the recent commits. It says that it's not only profanity, but it's origin profanity, which means that there is a branch corresponding to profanity on this remote location called origin. And now we can use this branch to create a pull request. But we will see that in one of the next episodes. That's all for today. May the Emacs force be with you.